Señor Cantor, so I'm going to be discussing some of the modeling work that we've been doing and integrating some fish nutrient excretion into the 1D modeling and potentially in the future 3D modeling. So I'd just like to acknowledge my co-author, Brenda. And a lot of people were involved in parts of this research, a lot of technicians from the University of Waikato, and also David Hamilton, Kevin Collier, and a lot of, especially like to thank Norm Hill and Erinu and Tarui. They contributed to some of the Waikato Whanui based interactions, and I'm not going to go over that in detail in this presentation. But also a lot of people could help with some of the input data and technical support. And a lot of the work that Brendan did was helped by Warwick and Dudley at the University of Waikato technicians. So pest fish and fish in general can account for quite large portions of the lake nutrient loads, fish metabolism, excretion, nutrient recycling, and as you know, koi carp can recycle nutrients through excretion and benthic foraging. So just a diagram on how this how these interactions can take place. Lake bed sediments can contain high concentrations of nutrients, so carp can really suspend and transport those, translocate those into the water column through their feeding activity. And of course we've got excretion, we've got interactions between multiple ecological levels, phytoplankton, zooplankton. So as you know, in the Waikato, koi carp can reach really high densities. They resuspend sediment, which can reduce light penetration. They can also make nutrients available for algae growth. So Brendan Hicks did a lot of nutrient excretion with carp and a lot of other fish species in it. So he captured carp in situ and did tank experiments to measure excretion in the lab, and came up with a lot of rates that we can actually use to estimate whole lake excretion rates and contributions to nutrient budgets. So in particular for this study, I'll talk about those koi carp excretion rates and short fin eels, or tuna. So I'd just like to mention that those rates, Brendan came up with calculations with that were temperature directed, so temperature affects metabolism and feeding. So the study sites that we looked at as part of this research were Lake Waikato. As you know, in Waikato lakes, a lot of them have lost their macrophytes. They're highly turbid, high populations of algae. Waikato is super trophic. There was a macrophyte collapse in the 1970s. And really turbid conditions, low secchi depth. It's got a moderate carp population of about 50 kg per hectare. In Mako Hinawai, carp at much higher densities, 300 kg per hectare. This is a fairly high density, but overseas, carp populations have been shown to reach much higher densities. So 300 kg per hectare is really high, and the ecological impacts can be significant. Like Wahi, macrophytes have collapsed. Secchi depth is really low, 0.6 metres. So just an introduction into Wahi and some of the concerns that have been reflected to us about tuna. There's a lot of mātauranga that suggests that tuna biomass has declined. Also, catch per unit effort, there's indications that they have declined as well. Causes of the decline, well, we're not entirely sure. Could be competition. In Lake Hinawai, after large biomasses of carp were removed, eel biomass actually increased quite quickly, so there's really good evidence that carp and eel are competitors, using some of the same ecological niche and competing for food resources. There's also things like habitat loss, macrophyte loss in these lakes, and changes in trophic pathways. So we need a way to start to integrate some of these nutrient excretion rates in field experiments and scale them up to a whole lake to determine what kind of nutrient budget effects or total effects these excretion rates can have on lake ecology and complex interactions between excretion of fish and chlorophyll A or other environmental factors. And so the best way to do that is to use a numerical model, ecologically coupled hydrodynamic models, of which some of these, David, our past lakes chair, has been instrumental in creating. One of them is Dorothy Cater. The other model that we used in this study is another one, Bessie Lake. So the general procedure or workflow is we need inflows, and they can be from a catchment-based model. We put the inflows into the lake. The lake is driven by meteorological data and also your lake bathymetry. And it creates time series of water quality variables. In a 1D model, it's vertically. In a 3D model, it can be vertical and horizontal. So this is an overview of the types of processes these models account for. They're very complex, can be thousands of lines of code, and try and simulate reality to the best biological knowledge and equations. So one of the things that we looked at was, especially in the Lake Ōtāwahi case, it was shown that when the carp were removed, the eel population recovered. So what would happen if you remove all those koi carp and replace them with that biomass was similarly increased with eel biomass instead. So eels from the same biomass excrete a lot less nutrients, and from Greenland's experiments and these model calculations, the actual fish contribution to the nutrient load can be reduced by 92% for total phosphorus and 72 to 74% for total nitrogen. So you can see that in comparison to koi carp, eels actually excrete a lot less nutrients. In contribution to nutrient budgets, carp biomass and carp excretion and nutrient transportation, these studies show that they can contribute significant amounts to total nutrient loading. So the external load from the lake catchment within Lake Ōtāwahi is about 50% of the total phosphorus load. We showed that carp can actually contribute up to 25%. There's some large error terms around some of this modeling, so these will vary based on various parameters that you input and assumptions, but the contribution to total load can be really significant. Similarly for nitrogen, carp can contribute up to 10% of the total load. And this is some work where you can take the outputs, chlorophyll A, TSS, and suspend chlorophyll A seed on the TSS, and you can actually use watercolour models similar to the ones Maritza described to model watercolour through time, not from satellite imagery, but from these models, 1D models. So on the bottom left is a simulation through time, and this is a restoration scenario where we're reducing the external load, reducing carp numbers by fishing, and encouraging, hopefully, macrophyte restoration and macrophyte re-establishment within the lake. So this is showing through time that the actual watercolour, simulated watercolour change from more of a bright green to more of a green and blue colour. In the Waikato lakes, because we've got high concentrations of seagull and suspended sediment, it's fairly difficult to restore the lakes to a blue colour, and as you can see through time, these more brown and yellowy colour events are due to high suspended sediment resuspension. So this was a visualisation tool that we came up with to try and represent some of the model results in a way that's easy to interpret. So the key findings from our studies, when you integrate removal of pest fish with reductions in external loading, you can create external load by significant amounts, up to greater than 50%. Can't just remove the carp and expect the lake to be restored in a lot of cases. You've got hysteresis, reinforcing turbid planktonic states. You've got, so we showed that carp can contribute large proportions of these loads, but also it's critical to manage external loads for lake restoration. Did show that at high biomasses, carp contributions to nutrient loads is able to significantly influence the water colour and quality of the lake. For example, at 300 kg per hectare in Lake Waihea, simulation can show that north TP shifts from a C to a D. So thanks for your time. These are a couple of references.